In this interview series from the CQF Institute, we ask leading quants to reflect on their careers, the skills needed for quantitative finance, and to offer their views on the latest industry developments. What do you think are the most important future skills aspiring quants should acquire?
Yes, well, quants have to be able to analyze data. And so in terms of skills, clearly they need to understand how to use computers. They need to understand how to use data. And that's a skill that, you know, one acquires over time by working with data. There's different types of data. There's, you know, big data sets, small data sets, time series, cross-section, et cetera. And, you know, quants should be very familiar with all the different types of statistical tools and also, you know, the newer machine learning and artificial intelligence types of tools as well. So a lot of different applications, but I would say that type of data analysis and statistical understanding of the data and so on, trying to figure out what's going on. It's obviously not an easy task, but one that quants really need to be familiar with. Now, when we talk about financial analysis, obviously we could go in a lot of different directions, but let's just stop there.
What does the rise of ESG mean for quant finance professionals?
Well, ESG stands for Environmental, Social, and Governance, and it's, I don't like to get hung up on the different words or all the different components to it. I would put it this way. I think there's a recognition now of the importance of sustainability, and when I think about sustainability, I think of leaving the planet, you know, at least as, in as good a shape as it was when we got here for future generations. And that, I think, is a very important concept. Now, how that gets translated into investments or policy and so on. I mean, if we look at climate change as a, you know, great example where we have not been operating sustainably, we have to, you know, change our behavior. We have to stop emitting these greenhouse gases. And so that requires, you know, important changes in the way we behave. And that means we have to change the incentives. We have to create incentives to stop creating that pollution. And so that to me is an example of sustainability. And that's really, to me, the underlying important concept. It's when we talk about environmental, social, and governance, there's all kinds of different dimensions to that. And I think it's important, rather than focusing on all those different dimensions, to focus on the organizing principle, which I think is sustainability.
How do you expect climate change to impact the investor environment?
Well, climate change has many different aspects to it. Clearly, we're going to have to reduce the amount of emissions. That's very much in the short run. And that transition to net zero creates risks and opportunities. Some businesses are going to be stranded. Clearly, we're going to use less fossil fuels going forward, internal combustion engines going forward, and so on. And so we're going to transition the economy, and that's very broad-based. It's not just the fossil fuel industry or the energy industry, although energy is clearly at the center of it. But then you have materials, you have, you know, the auto industry, transportation more generally, et cetera, et cetera. So it really has implications throughout the economy. That's the transition. But then when we talk about climate change more generally, really what we're worrying about is the impact on, you know, extreme weather and the physical impacts of that. What's going on now, the weather has already changed. It's warmed. The oceans are warmer than they were. The amount of precipitation has increased. Weather itself has become more chaotic because of the higher energy level in the atmosphere. And so what you're seeing today are events, the 100-year storm or the 100-year flood or the 100-year drought or wildfires that we haven't seen in a long time. And in fact, there's something special about a 100-year event along any of those dimensions, because that's the kind of event that we don't see very often, typically not in a lifetime, at least historically. And so we didn't prepare for those events. So if you think about the amount of damage created by different magnitude events, it's typically the 100-year kind of event where structures get wiped out. You know, it's not just 2% damage or 5% damage. When the storm gets that big, and now we're talking about a magnitude of an event, a historic kind of event, things get wiped out because we're not used to them. And the problem today, or you know, today and going into the future, is that these extreme events, these tail risks, are much more likely to happen now than they used to. So it's no longer a once in 100-year event. It might be once in 10 years or once in 20 years. And so we're seeing these events happen more and more often, and we're not prepared for them. So we have to get prepared. We have to recognize that the extreme events of the future are going to be much more powerful than they have in the past. The wildfires are going to be bigger, more frequent. The floods, the hurricanes, you know, the hailstorms, you name it, the heat waves, the droughts. So we have to prepare for those, and that's going to, you know, that's going to have significant impacts on people and on valuations of property. And in particular, sea level rise, which is something that's just getting started now and is accelerating. So that although we haven't seen too much yet, maybe a couple of inches on average, you know, in the next 10 years, we might see another couple of inches. And then in the 10 years after that, you know, it might be, you know, 4 or 5 or 6 inches. And it just keeps accelerating. So for people who are alive today, even very young people, sea level rise is going to accelerate throughout their lifetime. And that's going to have major implications. The Greenland ice sheet, which, you know, is hundreds of miles across and on average a mile thick, is melting. And it's not going to stop. We've already heated up the ocean. So it's really kind of inevitable. And that ice sheet has 20 feet of sea level rise at least embedded in it. So the question isn't, is it going to happen? The question is how quickly. And that really depends on how quickly we reduce our emissions. There could be, even in people's lifetimes who are alive today, there could be 5 to 10 feet of sea level rise. And recognize that at the end of that period, let's say at 2100, sea level is going to be rising faster than it had been until then. So it just keeps getting worse and worse in terms of the impacts. We have to be prepared to, you know, recognize these things that we've already put in place. And we need to quickly reduce emissions. I call it slamming on the brakes, because frankly, we haven't yet created appropriate incentives to reduce emissions. And that's what people respond to, incentives. That's what an incentive is, it changes behavior. And so we've got to create those incentives to reduce emissions immediately. And those should be strong incentives. We should have incentives of, you know, well over $100 a ton to reduce emissions. And we don't have those incentives today. It's really sad.
Are traditional models appropriate for ESG portfolio construction, or are new approaches required?
Well, I think portfolio construction is you know, a matter of risk and return trade-offs. I helped build a model years ago, the Black-Litterman Global Asset Allocation Model. And what that requires is inputs are, you know, estimates of expected returns and risk. And I think, you know, environmental, social, and governance principles, or not just principles, but data may have implications about risk and return. And so they need to be taken into account. But I think that framing, the traditional framing of risk and return, is appropriate for ESG portfolio optimization as well.
If you could go back in time, what advice would you give yourself when you first started your career as a quant?
Well, You know, when I was an undergraduate, I was at Stanford University, and that's located in Palo Alto. Now it's called Silicon Valley. When I graduated, I left. My advice would be you should have stuck around.
How did you begin your career in quant finance?
I started, my undergraduate major was human biology. I studied individuals, you know, as part of nature, as biological entities, which we are, of course. And one of the things I figured out early on in this human biology program was that people respond to incentives. So if you want to understand human behavior, you really have to understand economics. And so then I went and got a PhD in economics. I thought I was going to be an economist. I started focusing on macroeconomic forecasting. And then, you know, I started working at the Federal Reserve, and that got me a little bit closer to financial markets. And, you know, somehow I got a call from a Wall Street headhunter. I guess that was in 1986. And they were looking for quants on Wall Street. There weren't too many PhDs. One of my friends, I was a professor for a couple of years at MIT, and one of my friends from MIT was a young analyst at Goldman Sachs, and he called me up and said, "Bob, you know, this would be a great place for someone like you." And, you know, I was nowhere qualified the way you would have to be qualified today, but, you know, I was a quant, I had a PhD, and indeed, there were, you know, dozens of really interesting quantitative problems that I was able to work on when I came to Goldman Sachs in 1986. So that's how I got started. Early on, Goldman asked me to focus on risk management, and that I did, and I became head of risk management, and then moved into asset management, and that's how my career progressed.